Hi, everyone. Welcome to Being Patient Brain Talks. I'm Deborah Kan, founder of Being Patient. There's been a lot of questions around early diagnostics. We're hearing a lot more about blood tests that can predict or actually indicate early signs of Alzheimer's disease. Well, today we thought we would speak to one of those companies, Amanetta Diagnostics. They are a company that was rewarded a portion of the $3.5 million prize from the Alzheimer's Drug Discovery Foundation. They are adapting an early blood test to diagnose Alzheimer's disease. Joining me now from the company is Olivier Danos. He's joining us from New York. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
So tell us first and foremost, there's, you know, we've covered a lot of different companies who are getting into early diagnostics of Alzheimer's disease. How far away are we from actually going to market with one of these tests?
Well, our plan is to go to market within a couple of years. Actually, we were planning to go on the European market in 2021 and on the US market probably a year later. So we consider that we're pretty advanced in our development. We are finishing a clinical trial. We are confirming all our data. We need to, you know, follow up by getting ready with the production of our test kits and everything, and then this will be available. So, you know, we have prototypes which are being tested in the clinic, which have been actually tested on patient samples already, but the real commercial product will take another couple of years.
So we know you're looking in the blood, and we know that beta amyloid plaque which is one of the first presumed hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease, often presents itself long before we ever see a symptom of Alzheimer's.
Right.
So
right.
What exactly are you looking for in the blood to indicate that an early stage of Alzheimer's may be in place?
Okay. So our kit comes from a discovery that we made, or the scientists associated with the company originally made, that certain nucleic acids, RNA, that you can find in the blood, if you're able to analyze them and characterize them, then you can show that some of them are very specifically present in people with Alzheimer's disease, and sometimes with people with very early stage Alzheimer's disease. So to get in a bit into more details, those RNA that we're talking about are called long non-coding RNA. So again, RNA is what's produced out of DNA, out of the genes, and that this is the information that then's being used by the cell to make proteins. But not only that, it's also it plays a lot of regulatory roles in the cell. It kind of orchestrates the way the cell is going to work. And if a cell is sick, then this orchestrating RNAs will have differences, right? And the technology we have allows us to look very precisely at these differences. We can look at thousands and thousands of different RNAs and look at specific groups and see where they are. Are they overrepresented, underrepresented? And we can have like an identification card of a given blood sample. We can diagnose something like Alzheimer's disease in a blood sample. This is our goal. This is what we're trying to develop. So this is something that is possible now because the technology is so powerful in terms of analyzing these RNAs. It wouldn't have been possible even maybe five or 10 years ago. So this is something new, and we only have access to it now because of the technology.
So Olivia, do you know how, so if somebody is presenting symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, we know that, you know, perhaps plaques have already been present for some time. Mm-hmm. Do we know, when you say early stage detection, how early is that from the time, the presumed time you're going to see symptoms of the disease?
Well, I mean, this... I don't think we're in a position today to exactly say that, because we still need to analyze blood samples from people at all these very different stages, right? We know that at, you know, the prodromal and really or really declared Alzheimer's, we can see something. Now, how early can we go is something that we still need to fully investigate, and we're doing that, but this is going to be longer, right? That is there a blood test that everybody could have, like you have your, you know, cholesterol test or whatever, and you could have this one even when you're in your 40s or 50s, and then have some early diagnostic on what's going on. That's one of the goals we have. But I think that the first thing we'll do is have a test for that will allow us to follow patients, their evolution, and probably will usually facilitate the running clinical trials when you test drugs on patients and you want to see a response, being able to analyze and measure this response on blood samples is really a good progress, and it's kind of a holy grail that everybody's been looking for, because so far, to look at a response, you know, a biological response, not necessarily a behavioral or life quality of life response, which is more complicated to come up with. If you want just a measure of something, you have to go into the cerebrospinal fluid, which is difficult to take, or you have to to go to imaging procedures, which are very complicated and costly. So having a simple blood test is very important.
So when you were previously talking about how this new technology can enable you to detect the changes in the RNA, what exactly is that technology? How does it work in order to allow you to do this type of early diagnostics?
So that technology is that today it's a sequencing technology, a DNA sequencing technology, right? So you can take a blood sample, you can prepare all the RNA. You actually need a step where you convert this RNA into a DNA to be able to sequence it. But then you do what's now called next generation sequencing, which generates huge amounts of data, and you sequence thousands and tens and hundreds of thousands of different types of RNA within minutes, basically. I don't think I should get into the details of how it works, but this is really very powerful, right? You probably know that now it's, you know, getting the whole genome information for someone is something that's, you know, very possible and is not, it used to be something that would have lasted for years and years to accomplish, and that was the way it was like 20 years ago, but now with this new technology you can do this within days, right?
So this is a sequencing
technology. You get a lot of information. You get all this landscape of what are the RNAs which are present. And you can see that in a person without the disease, there is a given landscape, a given picture with a proportion of these different RNAs. And in a patient with Alzheimer's disease, there is a very reproducible and specific signature of the disease that you can see.
So you've tested, you said earlier, on animals, but you're relatively close to coming to market. What have your tests found in terms of accuracy?
Well, I have to say that, I mean, So we've seen this difference in landscape, and then we've identified specific some of this long non-coding RNAs that are all the time, you know, varying in Alzheimer patients. And now the test is to look only at those very specific ones, right? And the accuracy of it, the prediction is basically 100%. So this is very clear cut. This is not that, you know, you're going to have a diagnostic of, you know, 50% chance. This is absolutely, and this is what we're in the process of demonstrating in our clinical trial, which is finishing, you know, currently.
So interestingly enough, though, you know, the means by which we detect signs of Alzheimer's disease today are either, as you mentioned, through cerebral spinal fluid or, you know, getting a PET scan. Are the two, the two diagnostics that we have today. Most people obviously don't get those because it's too expensive. And interestingly enough, those two tests look for signs of plaques and tangles. But what you're saying in the blood test is you're actually looking at a much earlier stage. And so is it possible that this is even before plaques form?
Yes, because it doesn't, it's agnostic in terms of looking at a known target for Alzheimer's disease at, you know, amyloid beta or tau or whatever. I mean, something that goes abnormal and we know about, right? This is something that is maybe an earlier cause of that or maybe a consequence of that, but it doesn't matter. It is something that just varies in the system when the disease kicks in. The disease kicks in, it triggers many, many things, right? And the cell goes abnormal, neurons start to degenerate, and their whole landscape of long non-coding RNA radically changes, which is not very, this is not very much of a surprise that when a cell is, you know, not feeling well, I mean, everything changes in there. What's surprising is that in the case of Alzheimer's disease, it always changes in the same way. That is, we get, you know, we start from a landscape A and we turn it into a landscape B. And that's what we've shown. And that's what makes it very predictive because there's no hesitation. This is either or, right, in this case.
So just to translate this into what this means to someone like myself, you know, I have a mom with Alzheimer's disease. At what point would I want to get a early diagnostic test, especially today? I mean, obviously, it helps research to know and identify early candidates.
Yeah.
But me, as a person who has a family member, what does this mean?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the interesting question because obviously, in a situation where there is a treatment, you want to be tested. And you want to be on the treatment as soon as possible, right?
But what age are you talking about? So there's also people who.
Well, I mean, if there is a treatment, when we have a treatment that takes care of a good proportion of patients, such a test, I mean, should be done very early on, should be done, you know, but as a routine. In people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, and just, you know, just as you measure cholesterol in people. You know, you measure cholesterol, they are high, you put them on statin, right? That's, and you do that even when they are young, and if they're okay, you just wait until another couple of years or 10 years. And so it could be this kind of test, if there is a treatment, will be in the routine follow-up, I would say, of the general population, right? But I think now if you have a family history or if you want to know if you maybe think that something is declining and you have so you may want to know, right? And that's another situation where you could ask for the test. But we're getting into a little bit of an ethical problem here of having a test without necessarily a treatment behind that. You know, this, you know, such tests exist for other neurodegenerative diseases like Huntington disease, for instance. You have genetic tests for that. So you can have a 100% predictive test that you're going to have Huntington disease within the next 20 years or 30 years, depending on your age. But there's no treatment for it. And so doctors are not going to prescribe that to you. Now, if you really want to know, because you have a family history and you want to know whether you're, I mean, this is your decision and it can be available to you. But so those are two different things, right?
Yeah.
One is the way you deal with this in terms of public health, and then the individual decision of knowing about it.
Should I get a test? Well, I mean, it's much like what our genetically predisposed community faces, you know, to find out you're either heterozygous, homozygous, yeah. E4 doesn't necessarily
exactly.
get it, but you're still faced with that decision of finding out and how.
Right, right. And some people rather not know in the absence of treatment. And you mean, this is debatable, and this is everybody's decision, right? Yeah.
So yeah. When you say so far it's indicated you have 100% accuracy, where are you in the trial? How many people have been gone through the clinical trial? And, you know, so far, what did the results look like?
Yeah, so the clinical trial involves, if I remember correctly, close to 500 people. We're not disclosing the any data now because it's not finished, right? So we're not in a position to say anything. We just, you know, knowing what we know from the trial, we haven't canceled anything. We think we're still on track for our commercial product in 2021. But you know, the detail, I mean, we'll reveal the details of the trial once we get the full analysis. Otherwise, it's kind of, I mean, it's difficult to talk about it publicly before we have certainty about our analysis.
So you think, though, I mean, the clinical trial ends in 2020. So we should know by next year. And after that, I assume you have to get FDA approval.
Exactly.
Okay. So, I mean, it's definitely interesting. We know, you know, there's quite a few companies and research institutes who are developing blood tests to detect early detection of Alzheimer's. It certainly would change the landscape a lot in terms of what we know. You know, certainly for research, the earlier you know if someone's predisposed, I think that's good. That's a positive thing for research. So, Olivier, thank you so much for joining us. Please keep us abreast. We look forward to hearing what the results are of this clinical trial and understanding more about early detection of Alzheimer's disease through a blood test.
Okay. Thank you very much for having us, and pleasure to talk to you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
And for more on this interview, as always, we post them on beingpatient.com. You can go to our site and see the entire interview posted there. And please join our group Brain Talks on Facebook or visit beingpatient.com for more expert interviews such as these. We're keeping on top of the research at beingpatient.com. Thanks very much for joining us.
Bye.